Easter. So you have received emails from me already, but for anybody who doesn't check their email, our Holy Week services, obviously this is Palm Sunday this morning. Maundy Thursday and Good Friday are both at 7:30 here in the sanctuary. Easter sunrise service is at 6:30 in the morning at Fairview Lakes Camp. You know where that is, up the road. There will be breakfast afterwards. There may be a new way of entering, so give yourself a little bit of extra time to get there. They're probably going to stop each car and write down our names. And at that time, make sure that you tell them if you are staying for breakfast. And then they'll have a good count for breakfast. And I hope to see you there. Then, of course, regular Easter worship will be at 11 o'clock here in the sanctuary. And then after that, I will be taking a nap. And those of you that come to sunrise service, I would expect that you may want to do the same. So let's begin worship this morning by reading our welcoming and gathering prayer. Loving God, as you journey to the cross of Calvary, journey with us now through this Holy Week. Give us strength and courage to walk with you, to stay and not desert you when others turn their cries from Hosanna to Crucify. Help us to surrender to the fullness of our salvation. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Our opening hymn is page 278. Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Let us stand to sing.
And us. veil of invocation. Let us meet you here, Jesus. Let us meet you in the method of our traditions, in our prayers and songs. Let us meet you in our fellowship. Let us meet you and know you in the faces of each other. Let us meet you in each moment as we honor and worship you as our Savior, Lord, Messiah, and King. Amen.
Amen.
Or sing hymn 277. Tell me the stories of Jesus. The Lord is my strength and my power. The Lord has become my salvation.
There are joyous songs of victory in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly.
I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord.
The Lord has chastened me sorely, but has not given me over to death.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it.
I thank you that you have answered me and become my salvation.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Save us, we beseech thee, O Lord.
O Lord, we beseech you, give us success.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
We bless you from the house of the Lord.
The Lord is God, who has given us light.
Lead the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you.
Give thanks to the Lord, who is good, for God's steadfast love endures forever.
Our gospel reading today is from Luke chapter 19, 28 through 40. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethpage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you are untying it, just say this: the Lord needs it." So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, the people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if they were silent, the stones would shout aloud." The word of God for the people of God.
Praise be to God.
And discipline to walk with Jesus through this Holy Week. As a spiritual leader, I can share the gospel message with you, and we can walk side by side together to the cross. But each one of us will have to have our encounter for ourselves. Everything Jesus said, everything Jesus did, proved to us who he is. Every step he took led him to the cross to complete our salvation and onto the resurrection, offering us eternal life. We join in the celebration and joy of the resurrection when we accept Jesus' death as being for the forgiveness of our sins. It's hard to call Jesus' death a gift, but it is a gift of grace. Grace, the undeserved, unmerited gift from God. We are justified, made right with God through salvation in Jesus Christ by believing in him. And through our believing, we are presented holy before Almighty God, cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and righteous with the presence of the Holy Spirit for our daily living. But why talk of all of this on Palm Sunday? Aren't we here to joyfully wave palm branches and sing happy songs? Yes, but for us, it is bittersweet joy. We gather in the joy of Palm Sunday, but unlike those present that day for the Palm Sunday parade, we know what comes next. And it's not humanity's finest hour. It's evil at its best. It's evil that will condemn Jesus to death, and the shouts of Hosanna will change to crucify. Today we end our Lenten sermon series on surrender. During the past weeks, we have focused on ways that we can surrender our will to God's will, and we did so by considering the scriptures. Through our study, we have learned ways to align ourselves and our surrender to Jesus' teaching. We learned we can surrender by giving thanks in all things. We learned we can surrender to God by boldly standing firm on our faith foundation, trusting God to be the rock under our feet. Week 3, Anne spoke of surrendering by not holding on to the things of this world, like the rich young ruler who refused to let go. A hard lesson to embrace was surrendering as we considered our obedience, as we are called to trust and obey. The prodigal son would have been spared many a difficulty had he obeyed the father. And then last week we heard the story, the love story, of Mary surrendering to the Lord without cost, counting the cost, by anointing Jesus' feet with the perfume. Today's Palm Sunday parade sets the stage for the most difficult week in human history, when the shouts of Hosanna fade and the joyful heartbeats from the parade into Jerusalem begin to calm. We will be asked to walk on with Jesus. We will make our way with him to the cross, where we will come to the moment of truth. Will we believe? Will we choose Jesus and his sacrificial love and forgiveness for us, claiming our salvation? Or will we turn away, refusing to surrender, thinking like the prodigal son, we don't need the Father or his love? We can make it on our own and save ourselves. By the way, spoiler alert, we can't. These 7 days have changed the lives of countless numbers of people ever since. Every event has been an inspiration for the arts, where the image of God's creation and creativity has borne witness to the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Hard as it is to believe, for some people, perhaps those who had not encountered Jesus, for those who had no political affiliation, these 7 days, starting from Palm Sunday in Jerusalem to Easter Sunday, were of little significance. Sadly, some missed it. And some today are are still missing it. On Sunday, the first of the 7 days, Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey to the shouts of Hosanna filling the air. And he fulfilled an old prophecy in Zechariah 9, which says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." On Monday, Jesus walked into Jerusalem temple and overturned the tables where the money changers were. Roman coins were not allowed in the temple, and yet they were being exchanged for Jewish shekels. The image of Caesar was a violation of the second commandment, but the temple authorities were using the commandment as a way to cheat the people and making the temple a place of profit rather than a place of prayer. On Tuesday, Jesus taught in parables, warned the people against the Pharisees, and predicted the destruction of that very same temple. On Wednesday, the fourth day, we know nothing. The gospel writers are silent. Perhaps it was a day of rest for Jesus and his weary and worried disciples, or perhaps it was a day not unlike many other days in ministry, filled with sacred interactions between people and healings. On Thursday, in an upper room, Jesus celebrated the Passover meal with his disciples, giving it a new meaning. No longer would his followers remember the exodus from Egypt in the breaking of the bread. They would remember his broken body and his shed blood. Later that evening in the Garden of Gethsemane, he agonized in prayer at what lay ahead. On Friday, the fifth day, following betrayal, arrest, imprisonment, desertion, false trials, denial, condemnation, beatings, and sentencing, Jesus carried his own cross to Golgotha, the place of the skull, where he was crucified with two other prisoners. On Saturday, Jesus lay dead in a tomb bought by a rich man named Joseph of Arimathea. The Sabbath of all days, the day between the forgiveness of sins and the resurrection. On Sunday, his passion is over. The stone is rolled away. Jesus is alive. His resurrection complete. He appears to Mary, to Peter, the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, and the 11 disciples locked away in a room. We know Thomas was missing, but he too would get a resurrection visit. Jesus' resurrection was established as a fact from these witnesses. Christians around the world know these 7 days as the Passion of the Christ, Holy Week. And it all starts with the word Hosanna. The word Hosanna means save us. Did you know that? When we wave our palms and boldly cry out Hosanna, what do we really want God to save us from? Is it too archaic to say save us from our sins? Instead, do we say save us from anger? Save us from illness, depression, or debt? Save us from the difficulty of life and the strife in our families. Save us from an endless cycle of violence, bitterness, and arrogance. How about fear? Are these the things we need to be saved from? Aren't all these things part of the brokenness of our world? Yes, we do shout Hosanna and ask God to save us. Save us from our sins. Save us from ourselves, and save us and free us to receive the gifts of God for the people of God, grace upon grace. In viewing Palm Sunday from that angle, we begin to see the potential for for some real depth in the celebration of Hosanna. Save us. Please, God, take the broken pieces that tear us apart and make them whole. We beseech you, God. Hosanna, save us. Save us in our spiritual blindness. Save us in our lack of faith. Save us as we flounder around to find the truth in our world. Do we get it? If we do, the Palm Sunday parade is bittersweet. The joyous celebration begins a series of events that could not and would not be stopped. Corrie Ten Boom, a Christian Holocaust survivor, famous for her testimony of suffering, spoke countless times on how she relied on her faith in God to survive the concentration camps. I was fortunate enough to meet her when I was a teenager, and I heard her speak. Her witness shares with the world a powerful relationship possible when a person abides with God. And in a press conference, following a ceremony where Corrie Ten Boom was honored, one of the reporters asked her if it was difficult remaining humble while hearing so many personal acclaims. And she replied immediately with these words: "Young man, when Jesus Christ rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday on the back of a donkey, and everyone was waving palm branches and throwing garments in the road and singing praises, do you think that for one moment it ever entered the head of the donkey that any of that was for him?" She continued, "If I can be the donkey on which Jesus Christ rides in his glory, I will give him all the praise and all the honor." Corrie Ten Boom was able to surrender, not to her captors, but to God. She gets it. She gets the focus of the Palm Sunday event. She understands the place of the players, from those who are waving the branches on the sidelines, right down to the significance of the humble beast, the donkey, serving the master. She gets the humility necessary to wave a palm branch in the air and declare, "Hosanna, save us." There is beauty in the Palm Sunday parade that calls us to participate. There is anticipation and hope and celebration, and rightfully so. Jesus may not have taken that ride on a tall stallion, as maybe other kings might have done. Many thought he would set up an earthly kingdom. But Jesus entered in complete surrender to God, providing the way of salvation for you and for me. His task was so much greater than that of any earthly king. Will we walk with Jesus? Will we surrender to his love? Will we praise him in our thankfulness, abide with him in his suffering as a response to our salvation? And will we be obedient and stand there at the foot of the cross? Will we declare with others, "Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. You are my Lord and my God." If we do, imagine then the joy of joining him in his resurrection. I pray that we will, individually and as a church, stand with him at the foot of the cross. For we are the body of Christ in the world. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Most holy God, on this special day, we remember Jesus' triumphal entry into the holy city of Jerusalem. We remember how he took a pause and looked at the city and then cried over it. Help us to see the needs of our world as
as Jesus saw the needs before the parade began. As the people that day encountered Jesus, may we continue to encounter him in new and exciting ways. Give us courage to walk the path to the cross. In our journey, help us to see the needs of the people around us, those who are in want, those who are in need, and even those in plenty. Fill us with compassion for those who grieve daily. Help us declare Jesus' story to those who live without hope. May we be for each other and for the world a sense of strength and promise. In the midst of our encounter, send us your Holy Spirit to reveal the light of Jesus in and through us. In the unexpected places and dark and dreary places, fill our path with your guiding light. As your faithful followers, we ask for you to surround all in need with physical and spiritual nurture and divine hope for the difficult days ahead as we seek peace and love for our world. A world we boldly call your kingdom on earth. Hear us now, Lord, as we surrender to you by saying the prayer Jesus taught his disciples.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
We now come to a time in our service where we want to celebrate the gift of God for the people of God. There is an offering plate at both entryways to the church, and of course there are ways to give online. But giving to God is a way for us to surrender what we have to God so that people can hear the gospel message of Jesus Christ. This is what we declare this Holy Week. So let us stand and sing our doxology as we give thanks.
Oh, wonderful and
We are welcomed into that resurrection if we will only believe in Jesus. Believe in his love, believe in his forgiveness, believe in his gift of salvation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.